Welcome to the Everything Action Cast, the official podcast of everythingaction.com.
Hello and welcome to the Everything Action Cast, the podcast for the week of September 30th, 2024. I'm your host, Zach.
I'm your co-host, Chris.
Yeah, this week we're trying not to get absorbed by The Blob, the 80s version of The Blob, which got a fancy new limited edition steelbook 4K. I think it came out on 4K last year, but now that there's like a new collector's edition fancy case steelbook if you really want a collector's edition of it. But yeah, the 1988 remake of the 1958 classic that starred Steve McQueen. The 88 version stars Kevin Dillon and Shawnee Smith. And directed by Chuck Russell, who, if you look at his filmography, like, he had, like, a run there for a while from, like, the late 80s into the 90s. Like, his filmography was crazy. Because he did Dream Warriors, Nightmare on Elm Street 3. He did The Blob. Then he did The Mask. Then he did Eraser. And then he did Bless the Child, which is like, I guess it's probably like it's kind of like the outlier of like this run. But then 2002, The Scorpion King.
Yeah, like there's no rhyme and reason with his movies. It's not like he had a style that was distinct. That it's like, oh, you got Chuck Russell. It's like you're gonna expect a certain thing. It's like every movie is different.
Yeah,
you know, it's a completely different style and tone that. You'd be surprised. It's like, wait, this guy did that and this? Like, and it, I think, like, only, like, a handful of people he carries over between, like some crew and cast. But, yeah, it blew my mind that this is the same guy that directed Eraser.
Yeah, and the Mask, yeah.
Yeah, like, they're not even, like, the same type of, like, funny. Like, Eraser's action funny, and then the Mask is supposed to be, like, kid-friendly funny.
Mm-hmm. And the other thing too about The Blob is that he co-wrote the movie with none other than Frank Darabont, who, you know, obviously wrote this with Chuck Russell, and then went on to, you know, direct little movies like The Shawshank Redemption and The Green Mile and The Mist, and helped develop The Walking Dead and tons of other things.
But you know, I kind of see his Walking Dead like inspiration.
Well, I wonder if this is where he met Jeffrey DeMunn, who's like the sheriff in The Blob, because
I feel like in this that like they don't. I think they had like a friendship before this.
Yeah. Well, I mean, because obviously Frank Darabont's first movie directing wise was after this, like Shawshank, and then Jeffrey DeMunn was in that, and then Jeffrey DeMunn's been in every single Frank Darabont thing, including obviously The Walking Dead. But yeah, and then I feel also the thing about The Blob too, the 80s version of The Blob, is it's in this kind of like holy trinity, I think, of like remakes of 50s movies that are like as good or like arguably better than their predecessors, because you got this, The Thing, and The Fly are all like, you know, around this time, like late 80s, and they're all like all the 80s versions are like some of the like most critically acclaimed, like pushing special effects, pushing, like, you know, horror classics. But they're all based on, like 50s movies that are also considered classics. And it's kind of like, it's like that rare thing of, like, oh, the remake is potentially better than the original one. I mean, definitely, yeah. definitely The Thing. I mean, The Thing from Another World is fun, but, like, The Thing, like, John Carpenter's The Thing is just, like,
it's standalone.
Yeah, it's like one of the greatest movies of all time. So,
I feel like The Blob, though, when you kind of have its star in the same vibe as the original, where small town people interact with a blob like creature, but they really like fill in the background about the blob here.
Yeah, I feel like tonally, like, well, I guess, I mean, the fly, like the Vincent Price Fly compared, or was Vincent Price the Fly? I think he was, right? Yeah, like that one compared to like the, you know, the David Cronenberg one is just like, I was gonna say, like, the tonal wise is like totally different, like probably the most different is between like the Blob at 50s and Blob 80s. But I mean, the Fly 50s and Fly 80s is also like just like insanely different, like tone wise and everything.
True. I don't know. So it's like, well, it took a while for this Blob movie to be recognized as a good remake.
Yeah. Well, I think
it did terrible. So like, I think honestly, the first act is pretty weak. But parts of the first act are like a different movie.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the thing, like the main thing too, that separates this one from the 50s one is like this one just like takes like the Blob is such a big, like a such a like a scarier threat, and like the effects of the Blob are like so much more like horrific and gruesome.
Oh yeah, I kind of forgot how slow the first Blob is. And yeah, then when you see this, you're so blown away that this is just like 80s effects of like a tentacle monster.
Yeah, I mean that's the biggest like selling point of the 80s Blob. It's just like all the insane special effects and gore effects and the kills and people getting sucked, like people getting sucked into like things they shouldn't be getting sucked into and dissolving. But yeah, from the start, I do like. There's a lot of like fake outs, and I like the fake out at the beginning where it's just like, where like the credits are going to this like seemingly abandoned town. And you're just like, what is going on? And then you find out, oh, it's because everyone's at a football game.
Like everyone's at this football game.
Yeah, the entire town. There's just like papers flying across. Like buildings are boarded. It's like buildings are boarded up. It's just like, oh, is this like post the like this is the Blob already attacked this town or something? But it's like, nope. There's like everyone's just like. Literally the entire town is at this football game.
Which is, I don't know, pretty weird. It, like, I guess for, like, in the 80s, there's nothing to do. But these days, when the hometown has a football game, all that does is cause problems, like, for traffic. It's never, like, oh, awesome, like, the community's coming together. Now it's like, where is everybody at the football game? Like, what's going on? Like, there's nothing else in this town?
Well, I think there's a mention of like Fran, like the waitress at the diner, like mentioned something about like, oh, the town was having like a hard time. And now they have something to like root for or like cheer for or something. The football team.
Oh, I kind of forgot that. Like, is it something that like, the biker guy did? Because it seems like everyone in the town hates him.
Kevin Dillon, yeah.
Yeah.
The bad boy.
Because he just wants to jump a gorge.
try to jump a gorge with his motorcycle. And yeah, he's done something in the past. Because yeah, because like the sheriff is like totally out to like get, like the sheriff, the sheriff's just like, hey, you turned 18 in a couple weeks. That you don't know no more juvie. You're gonna go to real jail next time. Like. So yeah, so Kevin Dillon's been like up to some stuff, apparently. And then there's also like Paul, who is on the football team, and then obviously Shawnee Smith, who is a cheerleader. Which it's so weird to go back to like, after so many years of Saw with Shawnee Smith, just like go back and like just here's like a normal normal teenage cheerleader girl,
mm-hmm. And not just some like assistant. Like trap maker,
yeah. Not getting caught in like reverse bear traps or, yeah, putting people into torture devices.
Yeah, I also get surprised when I watch Becker and she's in it,
mm-hmm.
And she's like a snarky assistant. Did you watch a lot of Becker?
I maybe like an episode randomly once or twice, but yeah, I didn't watch it like regularly.
You're missing out, man. but it's so interesting as a like setup for this because it shows you the jock and the like preppy cheerleader, and you're like, oh, these are gonna be the main hero. They're gonna be the ones that survive this whole thing.
Well, they really build up like a lot of like the wacky characters of the town. They build up like you find out later like Shawnee Smith, like Meg's dad is the pharmacist, and then there's a whole scene with like Paul and his friend going to buy condoms at the pharmacy that leads like a wacky mix-up later on. And then like the reverend who's also at the pharmacy, and then you got like the can man who's the guy that finds The Blob to start with.
They call him the Can Man?
Yeah, that's like his credit in like the credits is like, yeah, the Can Man. Because he collects cans.
Not only collects them, he like crushes them with a handmade, like, over his foot pan.
Mm-hmm.
We're not going to talk about that?
I guess there's like, there wasn't like the redemption stuff yet, maybe. I don't know when that got introduced, but maybe he's probably just like crushing him. You get like a bulk deer for recycling or something. That's how he makes his money, I guess. But yeah, so this whole kind of like setup, like all these different characters in town. Also like the sheriff Jeffrey DeMunn is like, you know, he like asks out Fran at the diner, and then they're like setting up this whole thing. So they're setting up all these different characters, and then before like the, you know, insanity of the Blobs happens, before the Blob just like rolls it down and just like destroys everyone.
I do like that. Its introduction to the Blob is very, like, I don't know, like a slasher film. Like, it starts with, like, the Can Man getting on his hand, and then instead of saying help or something, he just immediately finds, like, a witness so he can just try to chop his hand off.
Like, oh, yeah.
Don't understand why he waited until that. Like, he's like, okay, now someone's gotta watch me do this.
Yeah, because Kevin Dillon tried to jump his motorcycle over like this like destroyed bridge earlier, and he crashed, and then his motorcycle kind of like conked out on him, so he had to like go back to town, get tools. He had to borrow some tools from like the local garage, and then he's in the middle of the night, he's like out working on his motorcycle, and then yeah, the Can Man runs to him, and the Can Man has like the Blob, like the start of the Blob on his hand, and then he tries to chop his own hand off, which the Blob like heals, I guess, or kind of covers up so that he keeps his hand on.
I think it just keeps his hand on. Chop it off.
So yeah, so it can like remain on the host body or whatever it needs to, like it's like food source. And then he runs to the middle of the street, gets hit by Paul and Meg, who are on a date. Which they had like the wacky mix of like there's what's Paul's friend's name? Eddie. Like Eddie's like buying condoms, but then he's like. Pretend like he runs to the reverence. He's pretending to be like, "Oh, not by cons. I'm not for me. They're for my friend Paul." And then like, the pharmacy owner was just like, "Oh, that kid is like out of control. That boy is." And then like, it's like that's who's taking out his daughter on a date. And just like he's just like, "Oh shit, you want ribbed condoms for my daughter?"
I mean, it could be worse. It could be he's in the pharmacy and he's just like, "Can I get some like Rufalin?"
Which I do love, like, so, like, Art LaFleur is, Tom, like, Shawnee Smith's dad. He's like a, you know, he's like a, that guy extraordinaire.
But he's a classic dad character.
Like, I love his line of just, like, there's, like, he just has one line when he, like, is just to Paul, he's just, like, ribbed. And then, like, the scene cuts.
Yeah, like, that's a whole different movie.
That's like a wacky comedy, like.
I don't mind that. That's why I like the break of it, and then you forget, like, oh wait, this is a Blob movie still, not just some teen romance. Like, but it could be. There's some parts of it that just seem very charming.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, but they all kind of like, so like Kevin Dillon and Shawnee Smith, and then Paul, like Donovan Leach, they all kind of collide together because the Cameron runs the middle of the road and gets hit by Paul and Meg in their car, and then they go to the hospital, and then things start going totally out of control because the Blob eats the Can Man. I mean, like, our first, like, super gruesome special effect is, like, the lower part of the Can Man's body is just, like, eaten.
But then it does a thing where, like, it infiltrates the Can Man's mind because his, like, his eyes go white and he's all, like, puffy.
Yeah.
So I didn't know that the Blob was in him, but then it just seemed like it perfectly just ate the lower torso and then left. Like, was it full?
I do like, so apparently I checked, like, Chuck Russell and Victor Amott said their idea was that the Blob is, like, an inside-out stomach. So, like, the acid's on the outside. And then that's why, like, just a touch of it just, like, starts, like, dissolving whatever it's, like, it touches.
I do like, the horror about it. It's not just okay, Blob, it just absorbs you. It's like, oh, it visibly digests you. Now
yeah.
you have the effects to be a very realistic level of,
and it's not like instantaneous. It's not like you're just like, oh, you're dead. Like it consumes you and you're dead. Like you're in there, you're inside the blob, like screaming as it's like dissolving you. Which is the other big fake out, the second big fake out of the movie, which is Paul, who you think is going to be like the main, like one of the main characters, gets just destroyed by the blob. Like the blob covers him up and totally just like eats him and dissolves him.
Yep, and it's so fast, you have no time to like you don't mourn him enough. Like it just sort of there he goes.
Yep.
And now you just have to deal with the rest of the characters. Then they start getting picked off. You know, like other people you think are gonna be like, okay, well maybe who's the real hero? Then it's like, oh, it's gonna be just Shawnee Smith. She's gonna be doing everything.
And Kevin Dillon, yeah. They're like they're a couple now. Like
well, I don't know if they're gonna be a couple, but then they had that date where she's just telling him to like help her.
Mm-hmm.
And there is an awkward piece of writing that happens where she does the freak out and then suddenly he just goes like, whoa, ho, hey, oh, I was just being the tough guy, you know. I'm actually really sensitive. I don't like, you know, like he was mm-hmm. so accommodating to her as soon as she was loud. It just felt very like, all right, like that's the switch. Now he's like willing to help her because he got yelled at. But then later on he has another moment too where he's like, I don't want to do this.
Yeah. So I look out for myself.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, that's right. I'm the bad boy loner. I forgot.
Yep. It is weird. Well, it is kind of weird, too, because, like, he did leave the hospital, so he didn't actually... Because Shawnee Smith's like, hey, you're the only one that will believe me. Like, you saw what was on that guy's hand. But then it's like, he only saw the tiny, hand-sized blob. He didn't see Paul get devoured by, like a human-sized blob.
Mm-hmm. So he doesn't know.
So he's not a witness. Like he can't back you up and say like, oh yeah, this pink blob monster ate Paul, dissolved him.
I mean, what's he gonna do? Like sue the blob?
And then the cops are also like, oh well, obviously like Kevin Dillon did it, or like he's involved in this somehow. Like he.
But then it's like prove how I was able to do this. I don't even know how like, a human would do like dissolve.
It's all less his hand, yeah.
Plus, like, he left earlier, so it wasn't like he was still there, and then suddenly that guy was, like, dead, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That's such a crazy, like, acid attack. If they're just like, all right, well, he was, digested, and then, okay, well, how did he do it? How did Kevin, like, Dillon do this? Did he eat him? Did he throw him up? Was he a fly man?
Did he just have, like, a giant, like... bottle of acid or like a giant barrel of acid. But Kevin Dillon, so he agrees to help Shawnee Smith, but then the blob rolls in the town and attacks the diner. And which there's like one of, I think probably my favorite kill is like the guy gets like sucked down the drain. In the diner kitchen, where like, it's
so about this movie. I saw this movie when I was way too young. It wasn't like a movie that was on like HBO, and I happened to like catch it with my family. You know, it's on. You walk in the room, and that plunger scene is definitely one of those like childhood things that just burns in your head because you've never seen anything like that.
Yeah.
And then just seeing a person just come pack down a pipe is so, like, vivid. That even watching this again, I was like, oh my, that is a nightmare of just getting sucked down and then probably getting mushed down that. Like, that guy was probably alive still at a certain point, but into a pipe.
Yeah, there's so many kills in this version of Blob where it's like, the Blob is just like, the force of the Blob is just sucking them into like a space that a human body should not be able to fit through, but it's like, mm-hmm. it's just like smashing them through it, dude, like sheer like pure force, like, yeah, forcing someone down a drain or like shoving someone through like a tiny window or like.
Yeah, once it just latches on, physics doesn't matter. It's just gonna pull and somehow compact people in the weird places.
Yeah, but yeah, that drain thing is insane. It's probably one of the best kills, just of how, like, because it goes on. It's like, it's probably the longest kill too. Just like his, like, that guy's getting, like, pulled down that drain for, like, quite a while, and then, like, just like seeing, like, you know, there's like an arm sticking out of there in a way that an arm should never be sticking out of, like, and then, like, the legs are being pulled through. So yeah, just awesome crazy kill. And obviously, like all this is all, like, practical too, because it's the 80s.
Yep.
And then I do like too, where, so, like, Fran, who, like, works at the diner, like, runs outside to, like, the phone booth, and then gets, like, kind of, like, killed inside the phone booth. But then you see there was a scene earlier where the sheriff is like, "Oh, I gotta go check out the diner," and then you don't, like, he doesn't show up to, like, he just, like, you see him in the blob already, like, dead.
Yeah, it quick cuts, and I didn't realize that was him when I was, like,
yeah, you see his, like, half dissolved face, and, like, flip by. So it's like, oh, sheriff's not helping. And yeah, and then, like, just, like, if the phone booth just explodes, that, or the blob just explodes that phone booth, and just, like, that impact of that is, like, insane. It was like a bomb goes off.
But what part I couldn't figure out is that, can the blob digest that phone booth, but it really wanted to crack it in? Like, does it know that it can probably eat through metal?
I don't know. I don't know that they, like 100%, like, explain it, but obviously, I think the thing about the blob is that the more organic matter it eats, the bigger it gets. So it really wants to, like, eat people and, like organic things so that it can grow. Like, it's gonna, like, smash through, like, you know, phone booths and windows and buildings to, like, get to people. But I think it needs people and, like, other things to increase its size. And then we get the crucial info in this, the diner attack too, where the blob doesn't like cold. Because it won't go in, like, the diner freezer, so Megan, Kevin Dillon, they're like, Brian are, like, safe in the freezer.
Yeah, the freezer scene, I think, in the original, doesn't happen until the end, right? Where they realize the cold.
Yeah, that's like the end of, like, the movie, where, like Steve McQueen and them are like, oh, it doesn't like cold. Get fire extinguishers. Get, like, we need cold stuff to, like, stop it.
But this one, they start pretty early to establish that rule. But they don't even, like, use it to their advantage until the end. Even then, it's like, that just happened to be, like, the right thing at the right time, instead of, like, okay, we need to get fire extinguishers.
Mm-hmm.
So I see the difference. But don't you think also, Fran, who seemed to be, like, a genuinely nice character, who, you know, was ready for a date, gave free pie, and then she died.
Yes. Like, well, yeah. No one is safe. No one is safe in this movie for the blob. The blob does not care.
No one is safe, but in terms of pacing, that happened. All this happens where all these other characters they introduced are gone by maybe, like,
yeah, they kill, more than half the characters they introduced in, like, the opening of, like, this, like, kind of, like, you know, like, tour of the town, like, just, like, stopping in, like, the diner and the pharmacy and everything, half of them are dead already by the blob.
I'm surprised the dad is still alive, you know?
Yeah.
Like, mm-hmm. He should have been gone, too, based on how this movie's introducing things. I'm glad he's not dead, because, like, he was a good actor, and, like, the story beat would have been more sad, but totally, like, you know, they introduce basically other characters who you just don't care about. You know, mindless other military guys or,
Well, we gotta mention Scott. Like, I think I said Eddie earlier, but it's actually, like, Scott, who's, like, Paul's friend, who's, like, you find out is just, like, an utter sleazebag.
Oh yeah. Oh,
if you couldn't tell by him buying condoms, but, like, when he's on a date with Erica Leniak, I think in, like, one of her first, like, movie roles, but then, like, yeah, he's, like, trying to, like, get her, like, super drunk, and then the trunk of his car is, like, he's turned it into, like, a bar. He's got, like, mixers and all kinds of, like, he's got all kinds of different liquors in there, and, like,
perfect warm spot to put your liquors and fresh fruit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then, like, this whole thing.
But the thing is, he's on, like, makeout peak of the town. And
yeah.
It's such a weird spot, too, because the Blob, during this time, like, terrorized the town. And then, for whatever reason, went back to the mountains?
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, killed this girl. Like, got in her, killed her, waited to be groped, and then killed, you know, like, the Blob at this point was just being a dick.
Yeah, we don't really get an idea of, like, the Blob's, like, intelligence level. Because that's like a very, like, you know, it's like a high intelligent move of, like, I'm gonna, like, pretend to be, I'm not gonna strike into, like, this guy that tries to, like, grope this girl. Like,
I mean, the Blob could have just been waiting there all day, waiting for something to happen.
He could just, yeah, the Blob, like, it seems like the Blob could just, like, yeah, absorb them both, but then it's just, yeah, this whole, like, fake out plot by the Blob. Which, that's another awesome effect of, like, Eric and Lenax, like, head just, like getting, like, sucked in, with, it's just sucked into, like inside out, or, like, just, like, in, it's like, looks like a mask, and then Paul gets, like, Scott gets, like, eaten as well. And then I think it's when the art, like after the diner, after that, the army shows up, like the special whatever unit they are.
They're like
a biohazard, like, army, like, special forces group.
For special forces guys, none of their shit's tech camo. They're all in, like, you know, giant white spacesuits.
Well, yeah, I think
do not make it sound like it's a covert operation.
Yeah. Well, I think I don't think they expected, like, an actual, like, creature. I think they expected, like, maybe, like, some sort of, like, did you ever read or, like, see, like, the, like, Andromeda strain, like the Michael Crichton book, where it's, like, the germ from, like, comes back in, like, a satellite, and then it's not a creature, it's just, like, it's a virus, but, like, it's, like, a space mutated virus. I think they're expecting, like, something, like, more like that, where it's, like, well, we gotta have these contamination suits so we don't get the virus infected by the virus, but it's, like, oh no, it's an actual creature. And I do like that, the main guy, like, Dr. Meadows, like, seems like he's, like, super nice to start with, and, like, he turns out to be, like, the most evil person in the movie.
Yeah, he starts out that kind of, like, okay, I'm doing this for the sake of, like, America science, but then it's, like, oh no, he is super, like, corrupted, I guess?
Well, he finds out they want the blob because they think they can use it as, like, a weapon against the Russians.
But then,
they'll drop the Blob on, like, Russia, I guess, and they'll just let him kill everything.
Control it.
Yeah.
So the crazy thing is, like, they're like, oh, this is great, we can use this as a weapon. It's like, well, that's if you can master the weapon. It's not like this is, like, this guy's plan was still pretty weird. Oh, that's, like, a destructive force. And then even the guys on their team, like, yeah, based on its growth, like, it could still wipe us out.
Yeah, sympathetic guy on the government team is just like, if we drop it on, like, Russia, or drop it, like, if we let this thing go, it's, like, there's gonna be no world left. It's gonna eat the entire world. And Dr. Meadows is like, shut up! we're at war.
Yeah, it's like, what? It's like, so dumb at that point. I understand, okay, you wanted to make a weapon and control it. But then someone points out, oh, we can't control it, and they're like, no, we can. And, you know, like, that's it. Like, the military guy that's in their crew should have stepped up and been like, alright, we're not gonna do that. But it's crazy, because it's not like they're like the heads, you know, and not talking to the rest of the staff. Everyone is there. Everyone's, like, in on it.
Mm-hmm.
But it seems like once that doctor guy's gone, then they're all like, "Oh, we should be nice. We should, like, save,
help." Not like the town isn't expendable anymore. Like,
yeah, yeah. But even that line was like, "What about the town?" They're like,
"Expendable."
Yeah,
Dr. Meadows is the kind of guy that, like, if they had to, like, he would drop a nuke on the town, and, like, if that would kill the Blob, he would, like, do that and kill everyone in town.
This definitely would have been a Morgan Freeman role, like he was in Outbreak, where it turned out he was like the good guy. But
like Morgan Freeman in Dreamcatcher.
That remember, too, yeah.
Remember, like he was like the like evil like government guy.
Yep, and he wanted to kill like all the people that found the
alien. Yeah. Demon? Well, there was an evil alien and a good alien in Dreamcatcher. But I think Morgan Freeman was just like, kill them all. We gotta protect America from aliens.
I'm also thinking, did Frank Darabont also do Dreamcatcher?
No, Frank Darabont did the good Stephen King adaptations. He had nothing to do with Dreamcatcher. But anyway, back to the Blob. So I think we like definitely got mentioned the movie theater scene, which is like, you know, obviously the 50s Blob, that's like one of the, probably the most memorable scene of the entire movie, is like the movie theater getting like consumed by the Blob. And then they recreate that but 80s style for this Blob, where it's, you know, it's way more gruesome, way more chaotic, way more crazy. The like projectionist gets like sucked into like the air conditioning vents, because the Blob like comes up from the like through the vents, and that's how it, and it comes through the projection booth into like the theater. And definitely no epilepsy warnings in the 80s, because that scene where it's just like the theater, like the screen light starts, the projection light starts strobing, is just like, man,
good luck. Kid.
Definitely, yeah, definitely could have used like a like flashing lights seizure warning for this one. I mean, it's awesome. It makes it look like it adds even more like to the chaos and just like insanity of what's going on. But like, even I was like, wow, this is hurting my eyes a little bit. Just like strobe, this like strobe effect.
Yeah, I love in the 80s. You're just like, good luck. We don't know enough about seizure lighting, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you want to find out until like Pokemon in like the 90s, whatever that episode was. But yeah. So and then like, I also love like the Blob is like on the ceiling and just like grabbing people with like tentacles and just like pulling them up into like the Blob, and like there's like people like on the floor like getting like half their faces are like melted off, and tons of great crazy kills in that one. And then Shawnee Smith finds like her little brother and her little brother's friend who snuck into like, which I also love, there's like a fake like Jason movie inside this movie. What was it? It's like the Toolbox Massacre or something. So you see like little clips of it throughout the like the middle part of the movie.
Oh yeah, the like hedger, whatever they call this.
It's like the Toolbox Killer or Toolbox Massacre, or like it's some sort of like, and then but then yeah, like the killer has like hedge trimmers. It's like it's the main weapon, and there's like that asshole in the back just like. Like is like who like I know all about horror. Like I've seen, he's either seen it before or he's like just like pointing out how like how tropey that movie is. It's like look at these girls are gonna like get killed now because they're having sex or whatever. Or like they're like the guy's gonna kill this guy.
Such a weird thing because he's like a grown like
redneck, like, yeah.
Redneck horror. It's just like what?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the actual director.
Is that Chuck Russell in a cameo?
I think that's Chuck Russell. Yeah. Because they say he's in the theater. I think that's him. He's the only one that, like, you see a lot of camera time on.
Yeah. And he's the first one that gets, like, sucked by the Blob when it flows into the theater.
Technically, the projectionist was.
Yeah. In the actual, like, main theater area.
Right, right. And you worked in a projection hall. Or a projection, like, right? So, did you ever stick your... Is there, like, a AC unit that built into the room like that you could stick your whole head in?
Well... The movie theater I worked at didn't have projectionists because it's all automatic. Mm-hmm. You so it's just like there's like a room above the theaters that like one big, it's kind of like a second floor with just like the projectors, and then you just like set, they just get like up digital files uploaded to them. Yeah, I don't remember. There definitely was like a some sort of like vent or anything. it's like you walk up the stairs and it's like, oh, here's all the projectors. So yeah, definitely not like an old school like 80s projection booth. And then after the chaos of the theater, like we get like the sewer sequence, which is also really great, like because that's even more scary, just like when you can't even see the blob, like it's like in the water somewhere and you can't see it.
At that point it becomes like a sewer monster that I think in the original one the blob never gets wet. Like I think the blob just is the slow moving creek dwelling one. Sewer scene.
No, I think it's pretty much stays about like up, just above ground, and like it gradually gets bigger and starts like consuming whole buildings, and you know, consume, like I think we mentioned before, like consumes the diner at the end, and then that's like the entire building is covered by the blob. But yeah, this 80s blob definitely much more mobile, much more like aggressive, like definitely has like different forms, or it can make things out of its like body, like tentacles and like a mouth, kind of like later on, like just like or like a giant like funnel. But yeah, the sewer sequence is great, like because it's just like yeah, it's probably the scariest part, where it's just like you can't see it; it can just like burst out, pull you into the water, which happens to like Meg's brother's friend, that who's like, oh, they killed like a what?
Kevin,
like a 12-year-old kid or whatever in this movie, and like horrific, like he just pops up like a zombie.
Yep. Hardcore. That's another like nightmare scene as a kid that I remember how like, oh, kids aren't safe in these horror movies, because you never really see like a young child get like attacked on until this, and it's been a while since we've seen this kind of like brutal child dissolving. But I like that the blob is just remorseless. Like, it's just, oh, I'll eat whatever. But for some reason, it really wants Shawnee Smith and Shawnee Smith's friends. Or Meg Penny?
Meg Penny, yeah.
Yeah, the penny just... It's almost like a Jaws creature.
It was like Jaws of Revenge, where it's like fixated on this one person. Like,
yeah, it's like, screw you. I'm trying to destroy
you. You got away in the freezer. I'm going to kill you.
Oh, do you want to go in on the whole, like, how, like, Kevin Dillon found out about this military conspiracy, and they were just like, we have to kill that kid?
Yeah.
But then when they come into town, it's like, okay, well, we don't want to kill everyone yet, but, like, they're expendable, but they don't do anything or, like... Besides trying to fuck with Kevin again.
Well, the government's trying to make it seem like there's an airborne virus or something, and they're just testing everyone in town to make sure like they don't have the virus, and they're quarantining the town. But yeah, the whole Kevin Dillon's like whole thing is like insane, where he jumped like so like they find like the government finds Meg and Brian in the woods, and they like, and he's like, hey, we're the government, like, and then they put him in a van. Kevin Dillon jumps out of the van like midway, like just on the road going to town. Cause he's just like, oh, like I gotta look out for myself, Meg. I'm out of here. Like, I don't trust the government, and just like leaves. And then he goes back and like he overhears like all the like Cold War. We're gonna use the blob as a weapon. Like, we're like, I don't care about the town. The town is expendable. He hears all that, and then like, and then has to like punch a guy out in the. One of the guys out because he gets caught, and then they're like, kill him, he's a witness. Like, and then I do appreciate we get the callback to like the conclusion to the setup of him, that like where it's like he has to attempt that bike jump again. This time he makes it.
Yeah, because of the courage from bullets. Bullets was the missing thing from his trick.
Yeah. The threat of death, even though there's already kind of a threat of death, because you're jumping over I guess it's not that deep of a gorge. It's just like,
you find out after he makes it that it's not that
deep. it's like a stream bed. It's not a canyon or anything. It's like an Evel Knievel jump. It's like, oh, if you fell, you might have twisted your ankle or like broke your leg maybe or something. But
Yeah, because I was like the big, like, haha, like, scene difference that you think it's going to be some big, amazing jump, and then when they cut across, you realize it's not as big. But every car that was following him, like, falls in that ditch.
Yep. They all can't handle, like, they all just, like, can't, don't want to do the jump or can't handle the jump. It's like, yeah, they crashed, like, this ditch. And then he drives his motorcycle into the sewer. Which that's a giant sewer to fit like a motorcycle inside of it.
He drove into like a power plant sewer. Like it was pretty big, right? But what are the chances that sewer also leads into like the main town like vein?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Unless do I just not understand sewer systems and it's like no, they all like meet up in the heart of the town.
And it's all that same size too. Like it's big enough. The whole way that he can drive his motorcycle all the way back into town. But yeah, but he rescues Meg, and then they do like a, he does like a crazy, like, it's not quite like that. Have you seen like that, like the, you know, like the ball, like the motorcycle ball at like the carnival where the guy like rides around the edges?
You have to go pretty quick to get.
Like, he kind of does that a little bit, because like he has to ride up the side of the sewer, like the round sewer tunnel, to like around the blob, and then get them, and then kind of they immediately crash. Yeah, it makes it, but then they crash, and then like they have to abandon the motorcycle.
At least that part's realistic. It's not like he did a perfect landing and it's just like hell yeah.
And then they like jump out the end of the tunnel or something. Mm-hmm. But then they run into that guy, like the voice of reason guy from the military, who's got like attacked by the blob. He's like the only survivor.
Oh, Jenkins.
Yep. Who also has
Jenkins also like he's the science guy and also a foot soldier.
I guess so, because he's got a fucking bazooka, like, which, yeah, it's, I love that the government like they see them climbing out of the manhole cover and just like seal it off, and they just like they just make sure they park a van on top of the manhole cover and just be like you're doubly dead, like even if you got climbed up to all this way, we're like you can't climb up because we parked a van on top of it. But then they forgot that they sent a guy with a bazooka down there, so then Kevin Dillon
don't know that guy was alive, but I guess they did.
He blows up the van and the manhole cover with the bazooka. And
oh,
like,
also, he does that one-handed.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That is the... He doesn't
he's like,
even...
Yeah, he's like... Because he's trying to, like keep himself away from, like, the blast. Like, but he's like... So he's, like, holding the bazooka one-handed, shooting it up into the manhole cover. It's like... I don't know how much protection you're going to get from, like, just, like, leaning away from the explosion.
I don't know if that's, like, a... You can basically do that and not get the blowback downward in that.
Yeah, I don't know how much kick a bazooka has, but I'm sure it's probably like you probably need to have both hands on it to like not break your arm or something.
Unless it's one of those. Well, it's a lightweight bazooka. Where
yeah,
it can extend.
Mm-hmm.
And you're not supposed to like put it on the ground because the air would definitely launch the launcher upward. So, but like the force, you're not supposed to like one-handed. I don't know. Oh, it's like maybe an 80s bazooka was different back then.
Well, even like Arnold, like, you know, Commando Arnold, like always fired like bazookas with like two hands. So it's like,
you know, Kevin strong.
Kevin Dillon can't. Yeah, Kevin Dillon can handle it one-handed, but Arnold can't.
Mm-hmm. And the movie's proven that he's secretly like a buff dude under all.
Yeah.
Other.
Mm-hmm. His he gets all his power from like his like luxurious hair. He's like Kevin Dillon is rocking like, I don't, is that a mullet or is that like, I guess that'd be like a mullet, like an 80s mullet.
It's not an 80s, it's not short on the side.
No, it's all, yeah, it's all long. I guess it's not really a mullet,
down,
but
so
yeah.
I'm not sure if that's a mullet. I feel like the movie guy who was talking in the theater was mullet guy.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm.
But Kevin Dillon kept his hair feathered, so no.
But yeah, and then so then they manage to blow up the manhole, and then they climb out, and then like Dr. Meadows is like totally like in full like psycho mode, just like kill him, and then he gets eaten by the blob, and then yeah, then I think we mentioned like all the military guys are just like, oh okay, like he's dead, like we're cool now.
It's as if they had a moment of, we're free now.
Yeah.
He's gone.
We're not under his, like, the tyrannical reign of Dr. Meadows anymore. And then they try to blow up the blob with, like, a satchel charge and, like, grenades and, like, all kinds of different things, and just, like, it makes the blob angry.
Machine gun fire down a tube.
Yeah.
And then, I don't know, like, it seems like they should have brought a flamethrower or something. Like, they should know something about the blob, but they are really just winging it.
Well, they don't, the government has no, that seems to have no idea about the cold. Like, they're trying to use, like, bombs and flamethrowers and grenades and, like...
What was the base of, like, the virus? Because...
Yeah. Because they sent something, that, it was, like, some sort of bacteria they sent up into in a satellite, and then it got mutated from space radiation, and came back down, and then that's the blob. But, yeah, we don't really get an idea of, like, what the, like, what bacteria it was, or...
I bring that up because just like in Evolution,
mm-hmm.
Do you remember that movie?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Heat makes things worse. Like, they didn't know that. So they're just guessing that with this, which I did appreciate about Evolution. They're like, okay, fire was an accelerant, and then the virus or whatever was evolving beat it on that. But this is like opposite. Like, it's weird that not enough, like, blob-esque monsters, weakness is cold. You know, it's the first movie, I think, and still, it's only, like, monster that the cold defeats it, or
mm-hmm.
temporarily does something to it.
Yeah, because they found out, yeah, fire extinguishers can, like, hold it off for a little bit, but then, well, luckily, there is a truck, like, a snow, I guess it's for like a ski resort, yeah. A snow making truck is in town, which, you know, lucky for them, that's like full of like, was it like liquid nitrogen or something in it? So that's like the big, like the thing that gets out the blob, which, you know, Shawnee Smith just goes full on like Rambo at the end, and like she's the one that like is like. She picks up a machine gun, picks up like a satchel charge. Like she's like got the plan to like blow up this like snowmaking truck and kill the blob with it.
I like how she's so badass about that. Then her dismount is completely right.
Yes, it's so good. Yeah, like she's on top of this truck, like firing a machine gun, looking at badass. So she's got the satchel charge primed.
But even then, she has a one liner.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I think what it was, but it was just like,
was it like a cold pun or something?
I forgot. And then she just turns like left and falls off the truck, and
her foot is stuck. Her foot is stuck. Yeah.
It does take. It gives something for Kevin Dillon to do. Like, he runs up and gets her off.
It's like, I'm the hero.
He should have been like a loner quote. Says, every man for himself. Or he looks around and goes, I don't have my bike. I don't know what to do.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm useless without my motorcycle. But yeah, they manage to get clear. They blow up the truck. It causes like the entire town to get covered in snow. Somehow. I guess because it's a snowmaking truck. And then the blob turns into crystals, which I think we got a hit of that earlier. Like, part of the blob got frozen by, like, the freezer or, like, the fire extinguisher or something. I think it was in the freezer because the Reverend, like, finds, like, he goes into the like, diner after, like, everyone got, like, left after the attack. And he finds, like, the little pieces of the blob and puts in, like, a jar. But, yeah, the blob is, like, turned into, like, these, like, crystals. And then they're going to store it in the town's ice house. And that's the only solution. We don't get any sort of like, not gonna dump it anywhere. And I can like, it's like, well, just put it in like the town's ice house. And hopefully it'll never unfreeze ever again.
This town will never have a power outage or something.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, don't like dump it down a hole or like, you know, put it in, like ship it to like Antarctica or like. It's like, yeah, we're gonna keep it in like where we keep the town's like frozen fish or like the town's like ice supply,
snow-making material. Yeah, at least in the original, they like fly it to the Arctic to drop it.
I think so, yeah.
But here, they're just like,
But then there was a sequel to The Blob, Beware of the Blob. So obviously that plan didn't work out in the original
one. I didn't see Beware of the Blob. No one talks about it, at least that I know of. Mm-hmm. Have you seen it?
I've never seen it, no.
See? Forgot that happened. And it's crazy, because this movie's also done by like one of the guys from the original and its sequel. Like Jack something. Mm-hmm. Jack Harris.
Yep.
He produced all three.
Well, I think Beware of the Blob is more of like a definitely leaned more into like the comedy part of it. It's more like a wacky like horror comedy.
Oh, that's why. That's why no one talks about it.
Yeah, I mean the original Blob is like the '50s Blob is like it's goofy now because it's from the '50s, so it has that like B movie like cheesy charm. But I don't think at the time it was like intentionally trying to be like a you know wacky comedy. But I think that Beware of the Blob is like we're a it's the Blob is crazy now, like the Blob is it's a wacky like goofy it's not horror anymore.
It'd be funny if the Blob in a third movie in the series and to downgrade it and the Blob helped like a little girl like reunite with her father or something stupid.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and then what do you think of the stinger of this movie?
Oh, I liked it. I liked how the Reverend, you know, he was trying to find signs, and he kind of did, and you don't know what's going to happen next to him. And, you know, it's like the cycle starts again, but it could be. You know, I like that. It even though it's like, oh, you expect the Reverend to just open that jar and shit's going to happen. I don't know. It seemed like he's going to be making bank. It's like he learned to be a marketing guy to
mm-hmm.
keep showing people the jar, I guess, whenever they feel like asking.
Well, he's now like a like revival tent doomsday like preacher, like prophesizing about like the apocalypse.
Yeah.
Which I guess if you got set in fire, I guess that would change your outlook on things. Which we forgot to mention, like, yeah, he got super set on fire. Like, because, like, the guy with the flamethrower, like, exploded, and then, like, he got, like, caught in, like, the fire as well. So, like, two crazy, like burning stunts in this movie.
Yeah, that's another thing about this movie does really well that I always appreciated. Kid. The practical effects still hold up. The mm-hmm. fact that they have, like, a set that, I mean, it's like a crazy set because the town is like double the space that a normal street would look like, but it makes for great action pieces. Mm-hmm. Same thing with the sewer.
Yeah.
But the reason I bring it up is because if you just edit some of the dialogue and some of the other parts of this, this would have been a more like popular movie for the masses of people who are probably used to, like, you know, like, it's 1988. The standard of horror movies are just slasher movies. So to have a creature feature that is in the right vibe of an 80s thing, but I feel like the soundtrack was missing, right? Like, all this Blob needed was, like, some poppy 80s song playing in the background.
Well, it's got that... The credit song is, like, a crazy, like, 80s, like, rock song.
I argue that the credit songs aren't the same as in-universe music.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, there should be some person with, like... Kevin had headphones on. His Walkman should have been, like, opened, and then, like, you could have heard, like, the soundtrack from his headphones or something. But I say that because this movie has, like, it wants to be cheesy, but then at some points it takes itself, like, serious. But setting a man on fire who, like, honestly did nothing wrong. All he did was, like, talk to some kid in a pharmacy. He found some pieces of purple things in the freezer. He didn't know what it was yet.
Mm-hmm.
And then he was set on fire.
Mm-hmm.
So for him to be like, he's not quite a villain, right? Like at the end, he just sort of has these pieces.
Well, the only thing that's weird is like, I feel like his like apocalyptic like preaching like idea like that comes out a little bit out of nowhere. Because like in the pharmacy scene, he kind of just seems like a normal like small town reverend, and then when like, when he sees like the blob, he sees like the like you know them trying to blow it up. He's like, "It's the apocalypse! It's the end of days!" Like,
ah, even that's what snaps. It'd be funny if he like ate that piece of crystal, and that's what makes him kind of go crazy.
Yeah, I think that would probably like just like yeah, it would just like eat him if by you know unthaw and certainly eating him, like he'd dissolve from the inside because the blob would just like burst out of his stomach or something.
It's like, oh, you weren't supposed to do that.
I'm trying to think when did I was trying to think too like when the stuff came out because that was like a couple years before the blob came out.
Like 1990.
Well, that was like it was 85 like the stuff.
What was it?
Yeah. So I wonder if people were just like, "Oh, this is like a ripoff of the stuff." I was just trying to see like what competition there was too for like August of like 88 when this movie came out, and there was like Coming to America, Dream Master, Die Hard, Cocktail, Young Guns, Midnight Run, Bull Durham. So there was a lot of competition in late summer 88. So that's probably why it didn't do well financially.
Yeah, and I think I saw this at like a sleepover on like DVD or VHS like years later, like after my initial seeing this at 5. I think later on, in, like high school. I saw this again with friends and it's like, oh yeah. Like people kind of forgot this came out, you know, I think because of like, I think Joe Blow really did a deep dive in this blob. And then I think Red Letter Media did one.
Well, it's definitely, I mean, yeah, it's definitely become a cult classic. Like people have like really appreciated it now. That's why we have like, you know, like the 4K that came out, like the limited edition, you know, collector's edition 4K came out this week. And then there's like other collector's editions and, I think it's the lesser of the three, but like it's definitely, you know, brought up in the same conversation as like The Thing and The Fly, where it's like these like remaking these 50s movies with like cutting edge 80s special effects and making them more gruesome and serious and modern.
Right. What do you think about like, I think, what is it, like, we're in the era this was a 50s movie remade in the 80s, so now it would be an 80s remake happening about now? Around the same time of an 80s thing?
It would be, like, it was 30 years from, like, the original blob to this blob. Mm-hmm. So you have to go 30 years back from now.
Yeah, it would be 88, like, around
this. Well, it would be, like, 94 is 30 years.
Oh, shit. Yeah, okay, I'm just ballparking the range.
Which I think we're definitely in mining the 90s for nostalgia, because it's usually always like 30 years from the time that you're like in currently. That's why like the 2010s is all about 80s nostalgia, and now we're like in the 2020s, so now it's like 90s nostalgia.
Right.
And then the 80s was all about 50s nostalgia. That's why, like, Back to the Future, like, they went back to the 50s, and they're looking back to the 50s for, like, to remake, see what they could remake, and I think the 90s, like, had a bunch of, like, didn't they have, like, a bunch of, like, 60s, like, you know, TV show remakes and stuff?
Yeah, that kind of stopped, though. I think after that Chips movie, there hasn't been another one like that.
Well, that was just weird. They missed the time frame of that one. I'm thinking more like, you know, we had like Wild Wild West, which is like, you know, a remake of a 60s show, and then like, I think, was it like Maverick was like a 60s show, and then like like Beverly Hillbillies.
Well, okay, those are TV shows. I'm thinking about like monster movies. There hasn't been like an original 80s Well, okay. To be fair, they can always remake the like Sleepover Massacre like 3 or whatever that one was.
Well, I mean, we're getting like a I know what you did last summer, like reboot cool. So then it's like 90s horror. And then we got the Scream sequels that just came out recently. So we're definitely horror wise, you know, we're definitely like looking back at like there's like starting to be like these like 90s like revivals. But it's weird because like most of the 90s like horror movies were like remakes of like older movies anyway, so it's like you're remaking a remake. Because it was like The Haunting of Hill House had I guess that was like the 2000s too, because like it was like My Bloody Valentine and like there was a new Prom Night, like there was Black Christmas, they all got like there was like 2000 early 2000s like remakes. I don't know. We could definitely tie it for like a new Blob. get a CG Blob going.
And
yeah.
See if they do it modern day, would it be something that the Blob would still be just as intimidating, or are we still used to like group monsters that if that showed up, they have to do something like a twist to it. Oh no, the Blob got into a car. Now it's driving. You know, like something. So
it can transform. It can like transform like a person, and then like the person
turns
pink, and then like yeah.
Because I think that's another thing about this monster is that even though it's more like scary looking, it still follows the same rule of the classic creature. You know, it can only do this. It moves randomly, like, you know, it slithers around.
It's still like it's still like purple / hot pink. Like,
yeah. I'm wondering if they do a modern update of it. And it's surprising that there's only like 3 official movies.
Yeah, the two 50s ones, and then this one. But yeah, that's the Blob, the 80s version, definitely. If you haven't seen it in a while, you go back and check it out, because it's got like a definitely, I think, especially like the special effects definitely hold up, because like they're fantastic. And then yeah, some fun performances, some fun kills, check out the original too, because the original one has like obviously like a lot of charm. Steve McQueen's in it, like it's got that 50s B movie stuff going on. So yeah, you can't go wrong with either version of the Blob for this spooky season. And speaking of spooky season, we're doing all horror movies all month for the podcast. Next week, we're going to be talking about Sleepy Hollow, the Tim Burton movie, because that's getting a 4K release for the first time. So we'll dive into that. All the Headless Horseman action next week. And we got a bunch of other horror movies we're going to talk about. And we're also doing spooky songs for every Monday for Musical Montage. We're doing like Everything Action Theater on Thursdays. We're gonna have a horror movie up that you can watch on the site. So I'm sure our commentary this month will also be some sort of spooky movie. So anything Halloween horror movie related is happening this month on the site, along with all of our usual features and reviews and all that stuff. So yes, I think that'll do it this week. And for Chris, I'm Zach, and we will see you next time.
For more from Everything Action, head to www.everythingaction.com. You can also find us on Facebook at facebook.com/everything.action, and follow us on X at EVAction. We're also on Instagram and Threads at everything.action. Find more episodes of the podcast on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or your podcast app of choice, and be sure to rate and subscribe.